let's talk about how to complete the reagent table that you need to have in your lab notebook before doing an organic chemistry synthesis experiment. And this is going to be a table that you create that has all of the reagents and ingredients, if you will, that are going to be added into your reaction. You have your starting material is usually what we call the organic component, a variety of reagents you might be reacting it with, your solvent and that sort of thing. So you're going to list all the reagents that are needed in the reaction. And then you're going to list the molecular weights or the formula mass for each of them and the density for any liquids that you have. And this information is either going to be found in your experimental procedure in your lab notebook, or you'll have to find it yourself, and you can look at the CREC handbook or an Aldrich catalog or something like that. Or it's really easy to find this information online these days. If you just Google it, you can probably find the Wikipedia entry for most common chemicals, and it has very reliable physical properties and chemical information there, and synonyms and so on. So that's a good place to look for information too. So the amounts that we have here are going to be taken from your experimental procedure. So, you know, the procedure is something like 2 milliliters of 2-bromoaniline dissolved in 10 milliliters of water, and to that and cooled to zero, and to that is added 1.9 grams of sodium nitrite or something like that. So read through your experimental procedure to see how much of each component you're adding. And then on the bottom here, we're going to create an entry as well for the product that we're expecting in the reaction. So this is what we're going to be making. It's just nice to include that all as part of your reagent table, even though it's not a reagent, because then all of your physical properties and masses and moles and that sort of thing are all in one place. So it's good to have that data all together. So the product here we're expecting is this guy, 2-iodobromobenzene. And what we need to do is we need to calculate the moles of each species that we have, and that way we can calculate the theoretical yield of our product. So let's do that. We're starting with 2 milliliters of 2-bromoaniline, and how can we go from milliliters to moles? Well, we can't go there directly, but we can go from volume to mass using the density, and then from mass to moles using the molecular weight. So we need to remember what the units are for density. It says it's 1.56, and the density is always given in grams per milliliter. So remember that water is has a density of 1, and so that's 1 gram for 1 cubic centimeter. A very small volume of water would equal 1 gram. So it's grams per milliliter, or gram per cc. And the molecular weight, the units are grams per mole. So the numbers that were given for their formula mass or molecular weight is grams. How many grams are there given 1 mole of that substance? So if we want to calculate the moles of 2-bromoaniline, we're going to start with what we are given, which is 2 milliliters of 2-bromoaniline. And then we know that every 1 milliliter weighs 1.56 grams. So I'm going to be multiplying by the density so that my milliliters cancel, my volume cancel. And so this would be nice if I wanted to calculate how many grams of the starting material I need. Let's say I wanted to measure it out on a balance instead of by volume. This would be the way I could do that. But I'm not interested in grams right now. I want moles instead. So we'll keep that data in our calculator and go straight on to moles. And we know that for every 1 mole of 2-bromoaniline, it weighs 172 grams. So now I see that my grams cancel, and I'm going to be at moles. So when I do this math, I have to think about how many significant figures should I have in my final answer. And it looks like all of our amounts are given in 2 sig figs, so that's probably a good place to go. So we'll get 0.018 mole of 2-bromoaniline. So notice when I'm showing my work, I put in my units, I put in what species I'm working on so that I'm not mixing up my problems as I'm working on them. So 0.018 is what I'll put in here for my moles of 2-bromoaniline. A lot of times these mole numbers are very small numbers, so if you want to have this in millimoles instead, you can multiply all of these by 1,000, so I would have 18 millimoles. That would be okay. How about the sodium nitrite? So we have 1.9 grams of NaNO2, and we know that every 1 mole of NaNO2 weighs 69 grams by its formula mass. My grams are canceling, and so this gives me 0.028 moles of NaNO2. So I could put that number in the table, 0.028. And we could do the same for Ki. We use 3.6 grams of Ki, potassium iodide, and we know there's 166 grams of that for every 1 mole. So our grams cancel, and we get 0.022 moles of Ki. So 0.022. So that's how we're going to calculate the moles of each species that we have. Notice I didn't calculate the moles of acid in this case. We could do that if we had the molarity of that. But that's how we would do it for our various reagents. And now if I wanted to figure out how much product I can make, what I'm going to calculate here, the amount I'm going to put here, is the theoretical yield of product. That's the maximum amount that I can make. And in order to do that, I need to look at my reagents and I need to decide who is the limiting reactant, which is the one that's going to run out before all the others. Okay, well, in order to figure that out, I need to know something about the stoichiometry of this reaction, because we've never seen this reaction before. So I'll go ahead and tell you that each of the components of the reaction, each of the ingredients that go in here, are needed stoichiometrically, meaning in a one-to-one ratio in order to make the product. Okay, so knowing that they're going to react one-to-one, I'm simply looking at the number of moles, and I'm going to find the one that has the smallest number, and that is going to be my limiting reactant. And everything else, in other words, is available in excess. I'm going to have some of that left over when the reaction's done. So I'm going to take this 18 millimoles, and I'm going to just transfer that down to my product, knowing that if I have 18 millimoles of my starting material, the most I can get out is 18 millimoles of my product. So I can use that now to calculate my theoretical yield in grams. If I have 0.018 moles of my product, let's just say, and I can use the formula mass, I know that there's 283 grams for every 1 mole of product. Now my moles cancel. And again, considering the sig figs, if we stick to two significant figures, I would get 5.1 grams of product. So that is my theoretical yield. That's what I'm expecting as the maximum amount of product I can get. The other thing that we can look at is this column here. These are called equivalents or molar equivalents. And this is a useful number to look at, because the number of moles, these numbers are kind of clunky and they're hard to compare sometimes. And so what we could do instead is just look at them in terms of their ratio. And what we do is we take our limiting reactant and we set that to be equal to 1.0. So if we have 1.0 equivalents of this, how much of every other species do we have? How much of an excess, in other words? So what we're going to do is divide each of these numbers by 0.018. So if we have 0.028 divided by 0.018, we get 1.6. So there's 1.6 equivalents of NaNO2. So that gives us some idea of how much of an excess we have. So we're not using twice as much or 10 times as much. We're using a 60% excess of the sodium nitrite compared to the 2-bromoaniline. Okay, we could do the same thing for the 0.022 divided by 0.018. And we get 1.2. So we got 1.2, so we're using about a 20% excess of potassium iodide. And of course, for every one equivalent of the 2-bromoaniline, since that's our limiting reactant, we can get just one equivalent of our product out. So this is how we'll fill out our reagent table. Really important to have this all complete before you're ready to start lab. This last column is a nice place to put any hazards that you have for various reagents, or any other relevant physical properties that we haven't listed so far. So maybe boiling points for liquids or melting points for solids and so on. And just one last calculation that you're going to need to be able to do. When the reaction's all done and we isolate our product, we are going to want to calculate the percent yield. And the percent yield is a simple calculation. It's simply the actual number of grams, let's say the actual yield, divided by the theoretical yield in grams. And we multiply by 100% to get that as a percentage. And that just is a reflection on how successful our reaction was. If we have a 5.1 gram theoretical yield, and let's say we got 2 grams out when it was all said and done and purified, then we would have about a 40% yield, because it would be 2 grams divided by 5 grams. So that's just one last calculation we're going to be able to have to do in order to complete our lab report. So I just wanted to make sure we had a nice background in the various calculations that you're expected to know for the organic chemistry lab.